Transforming 3.3 million square miles of sand into a forest? Very few know about this. Did you know that it's possible to turn a dry, arid desert into a lush, green forest? What if the Sahara Desert became the Sahara Forest? All 3.3 million square miles of it. Keep watching this video as we will discuss how this would be made possible. What you need to know. A new study indicates that large-scale solar and wind farms might turn the Sahara, the world's largest and hottest desert, into a verdant oasis. Simply put, this technology can turn a vast stretch of desert sand into a large piece of arable land. According to a study published online on September 7, 2022, by the journal Science, these farms have the potential to enhance rainfall in the Sahara, particularly in the adjacent Sahel region, a semi-arid area that lies to the enormous deserts south. This increase in precipitation leads to an increase in vegetation cover, which creates a positive feedback loop, said Yan Li, a postdoctoral researcher in natural resources and environmental sciences at the University of Illinois and co-lead researcher on the study. Scientists already knew that wind and solar farms could raise local temperatures and humidity. Li, who began the study as a postdoctoral researcher in the Department of Atmospheric and Oceanic Science at the University of Maryland, says it is one of the first to model the effects of wind and solar farms on the Sahara, while also taking into account the responses of growing green plants and trees to these changes. Large-scale wind and solar farms can produce significant climate change at continental scales, Li added while citing previous modeling research. However, the modeled climate impacts may not closely resemble their actual behavior due to the absence of vegetation feedback. What happens if the wind and solar farms Li and his colleagues modeled covered more than 9 million square kilometers of the Sahara? They calculated that over the course of a year, wind farms would produce around 3 terawatts of electricity, while solar farms would produce around 79 terawatts. Wow, that's a lot of power. A single terawatt is the equivalent of lighting up 10 billion 100-watt lamps. This is obviously considerably more energy than is needed now worldwide. Li added, in 2017, the global energy consumption was only 18 terawatts. Furthermore, the model demonstrated that wind farms raised the air temperature in the surrounding area. They found that wind turbines can increase vertical mixing and send down warmer air from above, leading to greater nocturnal warming. In addition, the average daily rainfall in locations with wind farms was found to rise by as much as 0.01 inches. According to Li, the amount of rain that fell was double what was observed in the control experiments. More wind and solar farms in the Sahara Desert could significantly increase the amount of precipitation that falls there. Researchers found that places with wind farms had an increase in rainfall of 0.04 inches per day, which would be beneficial to the growth of vegetation in the Sahel. The Sahel would no longer be considered a desert if annual precipitation increased by as little as 8 inches. And as much as 20 inches. Areas with a yearly rainfall of less than 10 inches are considered deserts. The study authors remarked that climate and precipitation would also benefit from solar farms. University of Maryland professor and study co-leader Eugenia Calne said, "We found that the large-scale installation of wind and solar farms can bring more rainfall and promote vegetation growth in these regions." Rainfall increases due to the solar panels and wind turbines' effect on land surfaces, specifically making the land rougher and darker. If this model is ever implemented, it could help economic development, agriculture, and social well-being in the Middle East, Sahara, Sahel, and other nearby regions, as stated by Safa Modashari, a systems scientist at the University of Maryland. Air quality expert and University of Maryland professor Russ Dickerson, who was not involved in the study, commented, "The Sahara has been expanding for decades, and the wind and solar farms might help stop the expansion of this arid region. To me, it seems like a win-win situation." In her role at Live Science, Laura oversees the archaeology, history, and life's little mysteries sections. She covers a wide range of scientific topics in her reporting, from archaeology and paleontology to physics and chemistry. Her articles have been published in numerous prestigious outlets, including the New York Times, Scholastic, Popular Science, and Spectrum, an online resource dedicated to autism study. Her reporting for a weekly publication in the Seattle area has earned her many accolades from the Society of Professional Journalists and the Washington Newspaper Publishers Association. Laura has a BA from Washington University in St. Louis in English Literature and Psychology, and an MA in Science Writing from New York University. NANOCLAY, the liquid turning desert into farmland. Inspired by the Nile Delta's secret to fertility, engineers have developed a mixture of clay, water, and local soils to cultivate fruit in arid regions. March of this year saw a stunning shift nearing completion in a sliver of the United Arab Emirates, right as countries around the world went into COVID-19 lockdown. In this landlocked desert nation, watermelons ripened under the Arabian sun in just 40 days, turning an otherwise empty patch of sand into a veritable feast. It was a remarkable achievement for a country like theirs, which imports 90% of its fresh produce. The barren, arid Arabian desert was transformed into a verdant fruit farm with just some clay and water. However, the use of liquid nanoclay, a soil recovery technology with origins 1,500 miles to the west and 20 years ago, made these melons conceivable. Egypt's Nile Delta declined throughout the 1980s. Although it was next to a desert, this fertile area had been used for farming for thousands of years. Due to its high yield, the ancient Egyptians were able to focus less on farming for survival and more on building a prosperous civilization that would go on to create cultural achievements for which they would become known for thousands of years later. While it had sustained local communities for millennia, it lost its vitality within a decade or so. The Nile rose and spread out across the Egyptian Delta plains every year in the late summer, and then slowly receded again in the winter. Floodwaters from the East African drainage basin that feeds the Nile brought minerals, nutrients, and critically, clay particles, which were deposited over the delta lands when scientists began to explore the decline in land fertility. The soil's durability and productivity were due in large part to the clay that was there. But where did it disappear to? Let's rewind the clock 10 years to the 1960s, when the Aswan Dam was being constructed across the Nile in southern Egypt. To make farming more manageable and predictable, this impressive structure was designed to generate hydroelectricity and regulate flooding across a width of 2.5 miles. However, it also blocked the downstream passage of all the beneficial materials. Without this yearly replenishment, the fertile soils of the Delta would have been depleted in just 10 years. Soil science and engineering researchers could start working on a remedy once they understand the issue. Desert Control hopes to transform barren desert terrain using nanoclay, transforming it from sand to hope. Growing crops with the help of clay has been a common practice for farmers for thousands of years. Nevertheless, traditionally, incorporating thick, heavy clay into soil has been a labor-intensive process that has also disrupted subsurface ecosystems. As a result of exposing sequestered carbon to oxygen when plowing, excavating, or reworking the soil, carbon dioxide is released into the atmosphere. Saran Sohi, a soil scientist from the University of Edinburgh, says that farming also disrupts the highly intricate soil ecosystem. Mycorrhiza, fungal filaments that effectively serve as extensions of the plant's root system, are an important aspect of soil biology, he explains. Hypha are microscopic, hair-like structures that cover them and are considerably finer than the plant's roots, allowing the plant to acquire nutrients that it might not otherwise find. By linking up individual mineral particles in the soil, the fungal filaments help keep the soil in place and reduce erosion. Digging or cultivating the soil destroys these fungal structures, which can take a long time to regenerate, leaving the soil vulnerable to harm and nutrient leaching in the meantime. Further research and practical applications are still required to accurately determine exactly how nanoclay technology and large-scale wind innovations can turn millions of square miles of land into arable farmland. Hopefully, more breakthroughs will be made in this regard, as it will help solve a lot of agricultural challenges the world is facing today. Thanks for watching.